And there came one of the seven angels, which had the seven vials, and talked with me, saying unto me, Come hither, I will show unto thee the judgment of the great whore that sitteth upon many waters, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. We see the whore, who represents Rome, very literally, seated upon the waters, which are shown as four rivers emerging at right to irrigate the world. In so far as this is an allusion to the historical Babylon, the rivers intended would be the Tigris and Euphrates. But what we really have here is a coded reference to Rome, so the waters are those of the Tiber, on whose shores the Latin capital stood. In this first image, the great whore holds a mirror and admires herself as she adjusts her brooch. We see here John's anticipation of what the whore will be like. In the next image, the angel has transported John in an ecstasy to where he actually sees her, which is why John is shown here carried by the angel. Before, he was only being taken by the hand. The reality far outruns expectation, and the angel provides a commentary that unfolds much of the symbolism. So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast, full of names of blasphemy, having seven heads and ten horns. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, and decked with gold and precious stone and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand, full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. And upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration. The whoredom here is metaphorical. Throughout the Hebrew Bible, the prophets describe failure to remain true to Israel's God in terms of marital infidelity. This venerable trope reaches a kind of apotheosis in the description of Rome as the great whore. It should be borne in mind that Rome at this time appeared to control and comprise the whole of the modern world, had recently executed Jesus, destroyed the temple, and abolished the Jewish state. John, voicing minority opposition to the seeming omnipotence of Rome, is understandably a bit shrill. While the whore is the spiritual essence of Rome, the beast is her physical and political being. The names of blasphemy are the divine titles assumed by the Caesars. The heads of the beast are explained in the text as the seven hills on which the city of Rome was built. The crowns are her provinces. The horns are powers allied with Rome, allies who will turn against her in the final conflict. And after these things I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and is become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird. What really requires explication is the exuberant and varied depiction of the birds. We have already seen feathered folk, in extraordinary and sometimes monstrous forms, disporting themselves throughout the marginal illustrations to the Cloisters manuscript. Why this fascination with fowl? Kenneth Clark suggested that birds appealed so strongly to the medieval imagination because their coloring seemed heraldic, and also they represented a freedom of movement unknown to any but nobles and artists. In those times, few ordinary people ever traveled 10 miles from the place where they were born. With this insight, we can better appreciate how the minor detail of birds roosting in the ruins of Babylon provoked this avian eruption, so lively and inventive that the very angels hardly outshine their feathered fellows. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, Come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues. For her sins have reached unto heaven, and God hath remembered her iniquities. Therefore shall her plagues come in one day, death and mourning and famine, and she shall be utterly burnt with fire, for strong is the Lord God who judgeth her. And the kings of the earth, who have committed fornication and live deliciously with her, shall bewail her and lament for her when they shall see the smoke of her burning, standing afar off for the fear of her torment, saying, Alas, alas, that great city Babylon, that mighty city, for in one hour is thy judgment come. The destruction of Babylon, Rome, receives a widescreen treatment, stretching over 2 pages. The angel's speech banner reads, Exite de illa, popule, go out from her, O people. And a mighty angel took up a stone like a great millstone and cast it into the sea, saying, Thus with violence shall that great city Babylon be thrown down, and shall be found no more at all. And after these things I heard a great voice of much people in heaven saying, Alleluia, salvation and glory and honor and power unto the Lord our God. For true and righteous are his judgments, for he hath judged the great whore which did corrupt the earth with her fornication, and hath avenged the blood of his servants at her hand. And again they said, Alleluia, and her smoke rose up for ever and ever. And the 24 elders and the 4 beasts fell down and worshipped God that sate on the throne, saying, Amen, Alleluia. And a voice came out of the throne, saying, Praise our God, all ye his servants, and ye that fear him, both small and great. Below the concise but complete choir of rejoicing spirits, we see the great whore, clutching her mirror even in death, as the smoke of her destruction rises from her. Thank you.